possibly inspired by yet more Old Testament prophecies that African kings would offer gifts to the Messiah. In reality, the first Christian king was here 300 years after Jesus' death, not present at his birth. But it's not the end of my journey. I've just discovered that there are pictures of the nativity scene nearby, and I'm intrigued to see what they show.
Here's the picture of the Holy Family. You can see quite clearly King Bassan depicted delivering his gift of gold. What's unique about this is that Salome is also included in the picture, the midwife. But what I'm struggling with is the fact that given that Bassan is from here, Ethiopia, and is an African, you would have thought they'd make some effort to distinguish his Africanness from the Easternness or Jewishness of the other figures.
Having set off deep into ancient Ethiopia to find the Black Wise Man, when I finally arrive, it seems to be the one place in the world where there's no Black Wise Man at all.
Now, this says a great deal. It's actually quite shocking. You've got Mary and Jesus, the Holy Child, using the same kind of colour symbolism that we find in the rest of the church, where the Holy Family are painted in a light shade. And then in contrast, we have a picture of the devil, and the devil is black. You know, this is some serious stuff happening here.
I think there never was a black wise man. Probably King Bassan never was a Christian, even though he was on the throne at the time that Jesus was born. 900 years later, the church elsewhere seemed to have created itself a black African king to tell a new story to a new audience. As a result, King Balthazar, unknown in Ethiopian history, was depicted as the black wise man in the nativity scene and still appears on our Christmas cards today.
The Magi aren't in the fundamental area of Christian faith. To paraphrase an earlier question, if a Catholic chooses not to believe in the literal picture of the Magi on the Christmas card, that doesn't put their faith in jeopardy in any way at all.
I like seeing the image of a black man alongside Jesus, but decoding his story has left me more eager than ever to remove the layers of tradition that get in the way of understanding the main event of the Nativity. In the next part of my journey, I need to go back to a time before the Nativity became so overlaid with code. What did the Nativity look like to the earliest Christians before the later traditions ran away with the story? And after Jesus was born, why was there such a break in the Bible stories of his life? The Nativity story told all over the world has spread from the earliest accounts of the Bible. But belief has become blurred as layer upon layer of tradition has obscured the original meaning of the event. Beneath it all was a single birth which altered the course of history.
This is the baby that changed the world.
But my journey to decode it has found a confusing mix of later tradition overlaying what really happened. I now need to go back to the oldest sources of this momentous event. This is Mount Sinai in Egypt. Since the 3rd century, there's been a monastery here guarding some of the earliest clues about the Nativity. St. Catherine's is built under the mountain, where in the Old Testament Moses received the Ten Commandments from God. Here are pages from the oldest Bible in the world and some of the earliest images of the event which changed the course of human history. I'm hoping that here, at last, I'll be able to decode the Nativity story that we recreate every Christmas and understand what it means for me today. This is one of the world's 8 earliest images of the Nativity, safeguarded at St. Catherine's on Mount Sinai. The art expert and nun, Sister Wendy Beckett, tracked it down, and she thinks it unlocks a series of clues about the way the earliest Christians saw Jesus' birth without any of the trappings of our nativity scene.
You might say, this is the minimal nativity. This is the nativity in essence. This is really what it is. The full story doesn't add to that. It just extends it. It shows how the early church looked at mother and child. So it's precious, not just for itself, but for what it tells us of that springtime of Christianity, that freshness and sense of wonder that perhaps we have lost or partly lost. One of the striking things here is that that face does show the man as well as the child. So we have the whole story of Jesus there. It's the most anxious face I know of the images of Christ.
I really like the way in which you describe the figure of Jesus and the anguish or anxiety that he has on his face, suggesting that the life offered by Jesus is therefore not going to be a life of ease. It's a struggle, it's a journey.
But he's not thinking of himself.
Yeah.
He's thinking of what he's giving, that way we may not accept it. Mm. I think that's the anxiety. Mm. So it's showing us that Jesus, fully human, was fully divine. It's not an ordinary baby, as one can too often see the images. This is what the Nativity is. This is Christmas. Jesus comes to us.
Also here at St. Catherine's are pages from the oldest Bible in the world, where the Gospel writers Matthew and Luke first told this story. It intrigues me that there are crossings out in the text. That's revealing, given how we hang our traditions on every word.
This is an absolutely beautiful Bible, one of the most beautiful that I've seen. The detail in it is absolutely stunning.
Among these exquisite ancient images, so beautifully preserved, I realised there's something odd.
The Nativity is quite simple in that the Son of God comes into the world unnoticed. But there are lots of things happening in these stories that suggest it is a big event, it is important. There are wise men who turned up, that magi turn up on the scene. There are shepherds who some people see as a little bit unclean, unkept, you know. They burst on the scene, you know. So even though it's an event which is meant to go unnoticed, the writers want us to notice that something major is happening, don't they?
They certainly do. And it remains a mystery as to why it remains so unnoticed. You have angels appearing in the heavens, you have wise men coming from Persia, you have the shepherds rushing to reverence him. These things would have become known and would have been talked about. And then it's as if Christ is forgotten until you see him briefly when he appears in the temple. And then you have Christ preaching in the wilderness.
The Bible tells us of the unforgettable events around Jesus' birth. And then, until he's an adult, he seems to vanish from its pages, apart from the briefest mentions as an adolescent. There's also something else that doesn't add up to the modern inquiring mind. Why don't any of the Bible accounts of Jesus' later life refer back to his extraordinary birth?
The Gospels were written first, and the Nativity story was prefixed to the existing document. This can be deduced from the fact that whereas the Nativity stories know what is in the Gospels, the Gospel story, which starts with John the Baptist and the public appearance of Jesus and finish with the crucifixion, never referred to what is specific to the Nativity stories, like the star or the wise man or the shepherds in Bethlehem. In other words,